please welcome on stage Mr. Isou Ibarbia, board member. Isou, welcome. And thank you very much for being with us today. Maybe we can start by what is CAF? It's quite interesting to see how your business is running. What is the complexity of what you're actually doing? Can you give us a little bit of background on how the company operates and what it's all about?
Yeah, so thanks, Manos, and thank you very much for the invitation to be here today. CAF, our company, it's an industrial company. We have a long history, and we make trains, passenger trains. I'm pretty sure that the majority of us, we have used trains made by CAF. Our vision is to be a relevant contributor for the sustainability of the mobility, both in urban areas and also in the main line. Trains are beautiful machines. Sorry, I love trains, okay? I used to play with tiny trains when I was a kid, and I still do it with the big ones, okay? So these beautiful machines are designed to work for 30 years or more in a very reliable, safe, and efficient way. Okay, so and this is in fact what we ask for to the ICT systems. Okay, this we need this efficiency and this reliability. This brings a lot of complexity. Okay, as you can imagine, I'll give you a few examples. For instance, the technological side. In the trains, we have electronics, we have hardware, software, we have communications, we have now cybersecurity, also artificial intelligence. So the key is not to master each one of those technologies in a separate way, but to do it in an integral way, in a single machine. Also, very important, the projects. Something that the general public probably doesn't know is that most of the trains are tailor-made. So this means that behind each case, there's a project with a big amount of engineering, and each project can take from the starting point to the delivery maybe 4 or 5 years. Also homologation process in the countries. We have to demonstrate that our trains fulfill all the safety standards to get a permission to circulate. And each country we have completely different standards and safety authorities criteria. Also interesting to say that in many countries we are required to produce locally. This means that we have to set up factories to produce the other trains, to manage the all the supply chain, the logistics, everything. So all together, I mean, it's a very complex thing. And as I said before, what we are asking to the systems is the same as our clients ask to us. It's to be reliable, to be efficient, okay? So yeah, we have to get the most of the new technologies, but it's also very important to not to forget the basics.
And it seems like we're speaking about a project manufacturing type of operation, highly customizing, customizable, highly complex, long delivery time. So there's a lot of data that is being generated by a train, apparently, or a bus.
Yes, it is.
While it's built and after it's built, after it's being delivered or operated. And probably data play a big role into your overall strategy. And can you allude a little bit into that? You chose to invest in BDC.
Yes.
You were one of the early adopters. What was the thinking behind?
Yeah, our decision to adopt Business Data Cloud is driven by both more tactical reasons, but also by a more strategical view. In the tactical side, okay, we were coming from DataSphere. We were using that, and now we are jumping into Data Cloud. We think that this will help us to better optimize the cost of these tools by consolidation of previously existing tools like BW, SAP, or BPC. Okay, and this also, at the time, I think we help us to deploy to more people in our organization. In the more strategical side, we think that this partnership between SAP and Databricks, it's quite a visionary movement, because this is going to allow to connect two worlds that up to now were separated, at least in our organization. On one side, we have the IT world, where we have, you know, all the processes, all the you know, manufacturing, the procurement, the logistics, the HR, and so on. And then the OT world, the world of the products, in our case, our trains, signaling systems, and so on. So in this part, we were using up to now Databricks. It was the foundation for a platform we created The name of this platform was LeadMine. And it's the platform, in fact, as you commented, that we use to collect all the information producing the incredible amount of information. And we use that to improve our maintenance processes using predictive maintenance algorithms and things like that, improve our designs, also the testing procedures and so on. So we think that this connection between those two worlds is going to bring good benefits. Here, I would also like to mention the zero copy feature. I think this is also going to help in the interconnection of the data and these analytic capacities between the two worlds, because we have quite nice experience accumulated over the years in both sides, and this will produce good synergies. And we also think that this will help to accelerate the adoption of these technologies by the businesses.
Brilliant. So you're setting your data basis, let's call it. You extend it even beyond ERP, as you said, with collaboration with Databricks that was already there. Yep. And you know, there's no way I wouldn't ask you the AI question. So what comes next? What are your plans? What are your thoughts?
Well, yeah, talking about data and so on, as I said before, we are an industrial company. Okay, we are not Google. We are not Amazon. And sometimes it's a bit challenging to talk about data and AI in a company with such a strong industrial culture, okay? So, yeah, to have good data, you need to have resources, and resources are, by definition, limited. You can have a very nice data strategy, but it's very important to have the commitment and engagement of the organization and the people. In that, if not, it's going to be very difficult. So our very first thing in this, our data strategy, has been to convince the organization on how important is this, okay? And to do that, we think the first is, the most, I mean, the easiest way is to show good results as soon as possible. So for that, we have adopted a kind of progressive approach. We have avoided to do super big projects. We have defined some use cases with an incremental level of ambition. I'll give you some example. For instance, we have created a kind of an agent, an agent based on Gen AI, to process requirements. In our tenders, we have large amounts of requirements. They can be technical, contractual requirements. And processing, analyzing, distributing all these requirements takes a lot of work. So with this agent, we are reducing it quite good. But for that, you need to have all this data, all this documentation properly organized. So this is, I mean, the results are being good. We are showing the organization that this can provide good results, and this is creating a kind of virtuous circle, okay? So this is the way we are doing. At the end, I would say the takeaway of this is, we are defining data governance. We are connecting data producers with data consumers. By the way, we think that sub-data cloud will help on this. We are trying to remove silos and things like that. But as I said, as a takeaway, I think it's very important also to take into account the contribution of the people on this.
Absolutely. Change management is super important. Absolutely. At the end of the day. Yes, and Isou, thank you very much. Been very insightful. Count us in this journey. And thank you very much for being
Pleasure.
Here on stage with us today.
Okay, thank you.